Welcome to the Ion Annapolis Local Business Spotlight. There are thousands of locally owned businesses in the area, some small and some large. Some you may know and others you don't. But one thing they all have in common is a great story, and we want to share it with you. Join us every Saturday as we talk to the founders, the owners, and the managers of local businesses you have come to know and love, and those you will come to know and love. Now here's your host, John Frenay, with this week's Local Business Spotlight.
Well, this is one of my favorite places to do a podcast. We're up here in Arnold at Mother's Peninsula Bar and Grille. You can hear the music in the background, which gives obviously a little bit of ambiance. But today we're here with Roman Hardgrave, who I had a... First time I'm meeting you, but we stumbled upon each other, I guess it was, back in the fall when you ran a, for lack of a better word, a shark tank at Anne Arundel Community College. Wasn't that right?
Yeah, it was called the Children's Business Fair. We ended up being actually in Arnold, but not the community college. We were down the road at Gloria Day Church down there on College Parkway.
Oh, that's right. That's right. Yeah. Was it supposed to be at the college?
No, it wasn't. I don't think so. I definitely was looking around. I was just trying to find a big parking lot for it, you know, for a while. And so I ended up knowing some of the folks at Gloria Day, and they were really supportive. And they said, yeah, you can use our parking lot. We're not doing that on that Saturday. So that's how we ended up there.
I think I do remember that. I think I screwed that up. Where did the genesis of this come from?
Yeah, so it wasn't my idea. This is a thing. So Children's Business Fair has been around, I want to say, for like a decade now. And there's
here in the area?
There's been some. There's one in D.C. There's one up in Baltimore. There's one in Bowie. So there's been some kind of nearby. There haven't been any in Annapolis, Arnold, Severna Park area. So I sort of learned about it through this school model that I was learning about. And it just seemed like a really great opportunity for kids. But, you know, the idea is basically take a kid's lemonade stand idea and say, you can do whatever you want to do. Sell whatever you want to sell. We're going to put a place together. We're going to bring people there, and you can try to sell stuff. And so it gives kids a chance to kind of flex their entrepreneurial muscles and say, I think people would want this or would want that. So,
well, I love things that can get kids thinking.
Yeah.
Above and beyond. I mean, I sit on a board of the signature board at Annapolis High, and it's great to sit there and see them starting, you know, to think and where it is beyond just the typical. I mean, when I was growing up, it was like, okay, you go to school, then you go to college, then you get a job, and you work there for 50 years, and you get a watch, and that's your life. Very simplistic, but it's not that anymore. And, you know, we've learned how kids learn differently and everything else, and I think it's just we're in a much better place as far as education goes. But stemming, and I don't know whether it's stemming from or in addition to or whatever, but you established the Maryland Curiosity Lab, which is at MarylandCuriosityLab.org.
Yep.
And was that the parent company of the business fair?
It was the kind of the main sponsor host of the business fair. And generally, the Maryland Curiosity Lab is all about giving kids kind of hands-on opportunities to learn by doing. And so the business fair was, when I was looking at sort of programs I wanted to try to do, it was number one for me. I was like, this is an established program. I love the model that they had for it. And the fact that it like really give kids a chance to succeed or fail. I mean, that's one of the things I really liked about it was the rules of the business fair. It's like, hey, mom and dad, you're not allowed to jump in here.
That's awesome.
And fix it for them. Because, you know, that's what happens a lot is that kids, you know, they struggle and the mom or dad jumps in and they don't really, you know, they get starved of that sort of learning opportunity to say, okay, like for example, my oldest son, he's going to hate that I'm telling this story, but he decided to sort of wait till the last night to do any kind of planning, right? So my other two kids sort of planned their businesses more. My oldest son was like, yeah, I got it.
And then, like, yeah, the deadline's not till midnight, dude.
Yeah, exactly. We're fine. It's tomorrow morning, Dad. And then he got there and he saw like other people's booths were a lot better. They had better decorations, right? And it's one of those things that's like, hey, like that's a great lesson for you. It's like, you don't put the prep in, like that's the outcome, right? You didn't put the prep in, so your booth didn't look as good, right? And I didn't come in and save it for you, or mom didn't come in and save it for you. So that was one of the things I was looking for, is a chance for kids to really try to do something on their own and really do it themselves. And then, you know, for this one, it was very practical skills. Trying to think of a business idea. This is what I think people would like. And then actually trying to sell it to people. Actually have people come and kids have to talk to them and say, this is my product. This is what I think it is. This is how much it costs. cost. You know, I mean, those are really great experiences for a kid.
And I mean, and that again is what Maryland Curiosity Lab does. It fosters this type of, I don't want to say, it's not necessarily all entrepreneurial.
No, it's not. Yeah.
It's that type of thinking.
It's definitely all like, you know, exposing kids to new things and allowing them to explore new things that yet they're not aware of. You know, so the typical kid can only, in terms of entrepreneurial type of activities, it's like the lemonade stand. That's sort of the end for most kids. It's like, okay, I can go make a lemonade stand. Maybe I run a lawn business or something. But generally, you know, kind of having a chance to just try something for a day, you know, most kids don't get a chance to do that.
Right. And what age group does that apply to?
So the business fair was ages 6 through 14. In terms of that sort of the range of the rules, and we actually did have that full range show up. So we had a kid as young as 6. We had a kid from Arnold who was selling these like such cute little cookie kits. He made these little kits that you can make sort of themed cookies. And then we had all the way up to 14-year-olds who are doing selling, you know, much more advanced stuff, jewelry, coffee bombs, that sort of thing.
Oh, very cool.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah.
I don't know whether it's a kissing cousin or a totally separate thing, but I know when I was on MarylandCuriosityLab.org, I saw you've got the Acton Academy, which really sort of piqued my interest. Appropriately enough, I got curious.
There you go.
And I mean, you are looking to establish a new school. And initially, as I was looking through, I'm like going, okay, so is this like an online thing or something like this? And as I got into it, I realized that, no, you're looking at, you know, moving dirt and building bricks and establishing a new school here.
That's right.
Tell me about the Acton Academy and where, and I see that you're going to be hopefully taking people in the fall of 23, which is
9 months from now.
Yeah. You don't look like you're stressing out quite so much yet, but it's
that's why I'm drinking the beer. So it is related to the children's business fair. Actually, the same people who founded the Acton Academy, the first one in Austin, Texas, also created the children's business fair. And actually, the children's business fair becomes a project of the school. So the actual school has this idea of these 6 week long hands on quests that you do. And so they're all different themes. Some are art, some are sort of STEM. One of them is an entrepreneurial one where you come up with a business idea in school. You're working on it for 6 weeks, and the final exhibition, the final project is show up at the business fair and sell it and see how you did. And so it's definitely linked in with that. In terms of the Acton Academy sort of, you know, writ large, I'm not planning to move dirt yet in terms of, so we start very small. So you start with like a core group of what we call founding families. We were talking 10 to 15 students when you start because you're really trying to get the culture right. And then you grow from there. And so, you know, maybe in a few years we'll be talking about actually sort of building a space. But right now we're looking at renting a space that we can sort of get started in.
What is the type of school? I mean, it's obviously it's not public school because we have plenty of them and they do a wonderful job here. It's not Severn and any of the private schools like that. It is, I guess, to a degree. Is this more like on the Montessori type of a approach concept?
Yes. Yeah, so it's got a lot of the same principles as Montessori. And actually at the very youngest ages, it is Montessori. So it's really identical to Montessori at the very young ages. But as the kids get older, there are other elements added to it. But all with the same sort of principles of Montessori, which is really about, you know, giving the students space to explore their interests and kind of get deep into something. That's really, you know, if you go into a good Montessori classroom, kids will be really focused, concentrating on something they're working on, and the teachers are taught, you don't interrupt them, right? That like they're into it, like let them keep going. So it's that same idea in terms of the Acton model, just Acton adds other things on top of it, and Acton goes all the way through high school. So you can actually go all the way from sort of very young ages all the way through that.
Is that your plan to eventually take this from your 15 groups of founding families to, or you know, to fully through high school?
That's right. So typically what Acton's doing, so you know, Acton Academy is a network of schools. So there's over 200 of them worldwide. It's not a franchise in the sense there's no like central headquarters that's saying do it this way. Every Acton is founded by families that are local to the area. There are a common set of principles that they follow. But in terms of the actual, each Acton's very different. Some of them are religious, some are non-religious, some are STEM focused or arts focused. But the plan is that you start at the youngest age, and then as the kids age, you grow the schools with them.
Interesting, because I mean, okay, so it can be totally different. I mean, we'll throw Key School and Severn School under the bus. Key School is very artsy-fartsy, and Severn School is very analytical.
Yep.
Both private schools, both very good schools.
Yep.
But they're totally different. Now, in the Acton model, you could have Acton schools sort of mimicking them. One could be very artsy-focused, and the other one could be very analytical.
That's true, but I think at the core, there's a big difference between the Acton approach and what I would call a traditional school approach. And it's hard. It's always hard to describe these things because, like, you know, within schooling and education, you get all this jargon, and it's really hard for parents to sort of understand what it means. So, like, the jargon that you hear with Acton is learner-driven, right? But that sounds a lot like student-centered or other things, and so parents are like, okay, what does that exactly mean? I think the easiest way to think about what it means is to compare it to what we know, which is sort of traditional school, what most of us went through. And so that model I call teacher-led. It's really the teachers directing the student at all times, right? So the student's listening, they're taking the assignments from the teacher, they're doing what they're told to do. So I would say whether it's a public school or a private school, most of them do a traditional model. Now, the private schools often do it better, like, you know, they have maybe higher paid teachers, you know, a better ratio of students to teachers. Sometimes they have extra programs around the traditional model. Obviously, better facilities often, like, you know, nice athletic fields and things like that. But the Acton approach, this like learner-driven approach, is really different in that what you're trying to do is you're trying to get the students to take ownership of their own education. And there's no time during the day when a student listens to a teacher tell them what to do in an Acton model. They have a lot more control, but also a lot more responsibility about what they're doing. So I don't know if it's worthwhile to kind of walk you through like a sample day at Acton, but it's sort of that's what kind of made it obvious to me what it meant to be learner driven.
So it sounds to me like, and obviously with Acton Academy not being here physically yet, it sounds to me like the kids are more, they've got ownership of their school and their education. And I imagine there's probably some study out there on the amount of days where the kids are like, oh man, I don't want to go to school. It's probably a little bit less than you would find at a traditional. And I get there's, you know, it's the sheer numbers. In Anne Arundel County, you're dealing with 88,000 students. I mean, you have to teach down to them.
Yeah.
You know, it's a top-down type of an education.
Right.
And certainly, when you look at any private schools, that they have the ability to, you know, lower class sizes, the whole nine yards,
right,
to be able to do that. But this is really kind of a unique concept that it's going to be student-driven.
Yes.
Do you know, as the founder of the school, and I'm presuming that, you know, once this opens, would your children be in?
Yes. Yeah, that's actually one of the requirements of opening Acton, is that they want parents to do it, and they want parents who are putting their own kids in it. Like, they really want you to have skin in the game of saying, I believe in this so much that I'm willing to start it, and I'm willing to put my own kids into it. And so every Acton is run by...
So do you know what type of a school Acton is going to be 10 years from now?
So you don't. I mean, that's one of the great things about it is that you're treating it like a kind of like a startup would, in that you're evolving it based on what works, what the parents are reacting to, what the students are reacting to. But you do know the core principles are not going to change. You know, like, really what you're trying to do is you're trying to get, a typical day at Acton is the kids have choice about what they're doing. Now there's high expectations, so they can't just not do anything, but they have choice. They say, hey, you know, today I'm going to focus on my math. I set some goals on math. I'm going to focus on meeting those goals. Or they might say, you know what? I don't want to do math today. I don't feel like math today. I'm just going to read my book. I'm really into this book.
And that's fine.
I'm going to hit my math goals later in the week, but they have to hit their goals. So they set goals and they have to hit them. If they hit them, they get more freedom and more responsibility. And they say, okay, you did a great job this week, John. You know, you hit all your goals there, so now you can go and study outside if you want. Or you can eat lunch whenever you want, right? And so there's this idea of giving them ownership of not just their own education, but of what we call the studio, of saying, you know, you can govern, like, what are the rules of the studio? How are you guys maintaining the studio? How are you cleaning it? You're trying to, I mean, it doesn't start like that day one, but what you're trying to do is you're trying to build this ownership over time to where the adult in the room is stepping further and further back and saying, you guys got this. you guys own it. This is figure your life, out. Your journey. You know,
where was that when I was growing up?
I know. when I saw it, actually, one of the Actons in, I think it's in Ohio, says, I think their tagline is something like, the school you wish you went to. And I was like, exactly, that's the school I wish I went to.
I'm assuming that there are the accreditations and everything else like that that go along with that. Yep. I mean, that's just sort of a given.
Yes.
And I'm sure you're probably going to join different associations that do their networks and stuff like that. But I mean, a diploma from Acton Academy, we're looking forward. Now at this point, is going to be just as valid as a diploma at Severn or at,
that's right.
Whatever.
That's right. Yeah.
What's your background? I mean, are you a teacher?
No. So, and if you had told me 10 years ago that I'd be trying to start a school, I would have been like, I have no idea what you're talking about. So my background was in tech. And I was very much in, I worked for MapQuest long ago. If you remember old MapQuest, was there a couple decades ago.
I printed out one of those to get here today.
No, did you? Yeah, there's not many people that do that anymore. But I was very into startups. And so that's where I was working on a lot of startups of different types at the time. And I got onto an online education startup. And that was sort of my first taste into education. I had never thought about education as what we're doing. I mean, it just sort of was, I was just like, it's a given. School is what it is. I was a good student. I didn't really like it, but I got through it and it's done. And that's kind of the last I thought of it. But then get into online education, which was about 11 years ago. I started working on online education. Started going to education conferences and sort of getting into this world. And at the same time, my own kids were just entering into public schools. So I have three kids and they're going in. And what I saw, like, going to these conferences was, like, just a lot of frustration from teachers or educators about the system's not working, like, we need to change it, and that sort of thing. But then I had a chance to visit some alternative school models. So I would go, I visited this startup school out in California that's now shut down called Alt School. There's this very interesting place called Workspace Education up in Connecticut I visited. And these visits really shocked me because I would meet students that were like middle school, high school age students, and they would just be so different than any middle school or high school student I'd ever met in my own journey. And it was just like they're really excited about whatever there is they're doing. And you're like, wow, so kids don't have to be sort of checked out of school or sort of like, school, it's annoying.
Right.
And so that process got me started to explore, like, what are these other models? And you realize that the model we have doesn't have to be that way. There are a lot of other approaches to education. And so that's how I got going on this journey of like, well, what is the right model for school? And I read about every model you can imagine. And that's sort of how I found Acton Academy along that way.
Interesting. Yeah. Now, as far as staffing, and I mean, you're coming from a tech background. Okay. So is there going to be online version? I mean, is that option? I mean, obviously it's looking to be an in-person type of thing.
Yeah, it's in-person. Yeah. So there's no online version of it at all. We think that the actual kids being together in that studio and taking ownership of it and dealing with the relationships of dealing with is really important. So there is no online Acton Academy model. There is a lot of tech used. So one of the big things that we do is sort of the core skills, which I would say is reading, writing, math. The kids are using a lot of technology for that. And the reason we do it is so we can personalize it to their level, right? So like a traditional classroom, you have 30 kids in the class. 10 kids are probably going faster than whatever the pace is in class and they're bored. 10 kids are sort of on pace and 10 kids are behind and frustrated or they feel like they're stupid or what have you because they're not following. A personalized model, what allows you to do is allows the kids who are going faster to move faster. It allows the kids who need more practice to get more practice. And so technology is a big component that allows you to do that because you basically have a personalized tutor for each child that they're working.
Which it really is. I mean, we had none of that.
Right.
You probably had some of it. I didn't have any growing
zero.
Up.
I mean,
it was the calculator, I think, was just
right.
coming out when I was going through, and they were promoting it.
That's right.
There's no way you could bring them into.
right, it's a test. I remember that. The graphing calculator was the way kids could cheat on tests.
That's right. Now they're like, bring it in. We assume that you know how to do the math, so
right.
you can use it to figure out the problem. Well, So how do we keep up to date on this? I mean, for people, the families that are interested, okay, you're not looking for 1,000 families.
Right.
Yet.
Right.
I mean, how do we find out, how do we keep up to date on what's going on? I mean, the fall of 23 is coming around pretty soon.
Yeah, so the best way is to go to my website, MarylandCuriosityLab.org, and sign up for email updates. So
and that's all spelled out, right? It's MarylandCuriosityLab.org.
Yep. And so if you get updates there, then you'll get all my updates. I'm also running programs this year. So we're kind of testing out some pieces of what we're going to use next year. This year, the business fair was one part of that. But we've done some things called adventure trips, where it's like whenever Anne Arundel County is out of school, but it's a work day for parents, we do some sort of fun adventure trip. So we did a great one just recently with John Fishback, who does...
Fishback is great, man.
Do you know John?
Oh, I know John forever.
He's amazing.
I used to run Cub Scout packs with him, and he used to come in, and we used to build the drums with the deer skins, and so he'd get the dead deer off of the road, and skin them and everything. We used to tick off the school because the gym would smell like dead deer guts for the next week.
Right.
But he's fantastic. He's a fantastic naturist. And I mean, my kids have done several birthday parties with him.
Actually, the reason he was on my radar, my oldest went to his summer camp a couple years and just loved it.
Well, I'll tell you what, it's probably right there on that point on the Severn River, way up there at the headwaters. Yeah. I used to keep my boat way up at Indian Landing Marina. And I remember one time just coming down to you, real shallow water, and then you get into some deep water, you give it some gas, and you come around the corner, and next thing you know, there's John and a whole bunch of people in like their camouflage suits, chest deep in the water, doing some damn survival thing. I'm like, going, dude, man, I'm going to kill you.
I know Zach, because we actually hiked that same spot with him. I know exactly what you're talking about. Yeah, so we did one of those, like we did an outdoor survival skills day, and the kids got to build blow darts and make bone knives and start fires and cook deer over the fire. So it's just like that sort of stuff. And the kids love it. You know, the kids, like, there's a no phone rule. So it's like no smartphones, guys. Like, we're just going to go out there and have fun. And it's what's amazing is the kids, I knew the parents would like that. The kids actually like it a lot. I had kids come up to me and say, it's great when nobody has their phone, because like it ends up being that if one kid's on their phone, other kids get their phone out, or we all kind of look over their shoulder. And so when there's no phones, they just, it's sort of like they get to be kids like we were kids.
I think a little bit of that is that everybody, we've got, it's gonna sound wrong, but I think we've got an anti-social generation. I know my daughter was like, okay, I'm going out tonight. I've ordered a pizza for you. $20 on the table. I don't need any change.
Yeah.
Well, why are you leaving? Because I'm going out.
Yeah.
Well, what do I do when the pizza guy comes? Open the door, say hello, and give him the $20. He'll give you pizza. This is how it works.
Yeah.
Can't you just wait until he's gone, until he's here? And I'm like, no. And, you're going to need to learn how to do this. And I think that phones tend to be a crutch
for
people. I mean, hey, I've got this. Okay. I'm not sure what my next question is going to be and discussion topic with you. So I'm going to play Words with Friends.
Right.
And then you get involved with the whole thing there, as opposed to when you don't have them. Okay, now it's... What do I have to do? I got to say something to Roman here. You're sitting here looking at me like I'm an idiot.
Yeah, no, I agree. And actually, I have a buddy who teaches at high school at Broadneck High School. And he said the exact same thing. He says the kids are really use it as a crutch, or the kids who are a little bit awkward, who actually need that experience of social interaction. And they end up being people, he says he'll see them. They'll be sitting in class. Other kids will come in and they'll pull their phone out so they don't have to engage, they can just sort of...
It can just be something that's silly and they don't get it. It's like, hey, how you doing? We're done.
Right. No,
but it's interesting. So you do this stuff when the schools are out, which is fantastic for parents.
Yes.
And, the kids don't really, the younger ones anyhow, don't realize they're learning anything, I guess.
Oh, they don't think it. Yeah, they think it's just like a fun trip, And so, they get upset because I don't do more of them, but they're sort of hard to organize and everything. So I don't do them every school day off, but I try to hit kind of every other one. But
you might go out of business by trying to plan off.
Oh man,
all the days they have.
And I'm always trying to find places that we can go to that are like really interesting that the kids haven't been to before. So like John's was great because I knew most kids had not done outdoor survival stuff, and even if you're into it or not, it's still interesting, right? The first time you get, you're like, oh, wow. I mean, like cooking deer over a fire is new for most kids. They've never done that.
For most people, period.
Yeah, and so I'm always trying to find these sort of places where I can take them to that are really different and expose them. The hope is that they go on a trip and at least a few kids get a spark of interest and they're say, you know, I'm actually really into that. I would like to do more of it. You know, like, can I go to John's camp? And actually a bunch of kids did that. They're like, I want to go to John's summer camp now. I'm like, that's great. That's what I want. I want a couple kids to hopefully find a hobby or a passion or whatever, you know, for their life.
Right. Well, if you want a suggestion, the Annapolis Maritime Museum.
They're on my list, actually.
And the Skipjack Wilmalee is really kind of fantastic. It's got a bunch of history. It's a lot of fun. They can help sail it and stuff like that.
That'd be great.
And I learned something pretty cool about that. Do you know that there is no set length for a skipjack?
No, I didn't know that.
It all is proportionate, and it depends on how tall the tree is that you cut down for the mast.
Really?
And I can't remember exactly what it is, but I mean, if you cut down a tree and you trim it out and make the mast and it's 40 feet long,
yep.
Then from that dimension, you can tell what the berth is going to be, what the deck length is going to be, and that's what you build your ship around, or your boat around that mast, which is, so you turn around, you can see a short little stubby skipjack versus a big long.
Yeah.
You know, but it's, that'd be a good choice for you to take a look at.
Yeah,
and see
actually, I think boating is a great learning opportunity. Like, there's actually a program called Semester at Sea. That's for high schoolers, and where the whole semester they're at sea, and they're learning all different sorts of things. But like, there's so much math and other things you can learn through navigation and you know, reading compasses and dealing with all that stuff, and just like responsibility. You know, if you're running a boat, you got to be careful, right? Like, it's not, you know, so like the kids can really get into a position where they can fail, but then, you know, overcome it type of thing.
Right. That's fantastic. What's look forward in 10 years from now, 10, 15 years from now? I mean, how large do we picture Acton Academy being? I mean, you said it starts very small. It doesn't sound like it's going to be this 88,000 students, you know, group.
Yeah, that's a great question. Some of the other Actons, I say, have grown to the size where you would just like, oh, that's just a normal private school. So there's no kind of cap on it. In terms of like, what I hope to get out of it is, obviously, the more kids I can help have a great education, the better. I would love that. But to me, what I'm trying to build is a place like, you know, the actual name Maryland Curiosity Lab came from this idea of like, what would it be like if you went to a place where like your curiosity was piqued all the time? You know, we've all sort of had this feeling when we're learning something where it doesn't feel like work, where it's just like you're obsessed with learning something, right? And it's usually always sort of like by luck. You run into somebody who shows you something, or you read a book, or see a movie or something. But it's always like by chance, right? It doesn't seem to happen that often. And those things are often change your life when you run into them and become a hobby or passion or a career or whatever. And, you know, my hope is like, there's no reason why it has to happen so rarely. Like, there's the world is very interesting to explore. It's just a matter of like putting it in front of kids so they can explore. And so my hope is that like, I can live up to the name, right? Where like, you go there and you're like, mom, my gosh, I learned this thing or this thing. It's almost like guaranteed every kid who shows up is going to be super excited about learning something, like whatever that something is. Like,
and again, those conversations at dinner aren't going to be, so what did you learn at school today?
Nothing. We have a rule now. We're like, no, you have to say one thing. I don't care what it is.
Right.
You can't just say,
there's new graffiti in the bathroom. But, you know, it's okay, fine. It's a little bit.
Yeah.
But, That's fantastic, because there really is, as you go through life, I mean, you know, there's that old adage that, you know, if you have a job that you love, you'll never have a crappy day and,
right,
you know, a work day. And I found in the different aspects of my life and the different positions in my life that when you really are engaged in learning about what it is and you enjoy what you're doing, I mean, and it's a snowball effect there. Success follows.
Yeah.
It really, I mean, you're going to have, you know, stumbling blocks and everything else, and you're going to struggle.
Yeah.
That's, you know, not without struggles or something like that. But you find that you want to learn something, and that drives you. I mean, whether it's solving a problem, figuring out, okay, why is this doing this? And
right,
maybe you become obsessive over it, but again, right, it's something that enthuses you. It's like, yeah, no, Dad, we're not going to dinner. No, I need to figure this out.
Right,
which is amazing when you see that level of commitment come through a kid.
Right. Yeah, I totally agree. And that was my own experience. I wasn't really interested in learning through school at all. It wasn't until sort of I got out of school for a while, and then I just kind of got lucky and discovered a few things. And all of a sudden, it was like, this doesn't feel like work at all. I mean, sometimes it's hard. You know, learning's not always easy, but it was like something you really wanted to do. And you're like, man, I'm now that I know I don't know something, I'm really curious to figure it out.
Right.
You know? And yeah, I mean, I think those opportunities are out there to be had for kids. You know, just a matter of like, how do you sort of expose them to stuff? And so the business fair, the venture trips, those are all sort of in that same idea of like, you know, can I expose a kid to some experience that all of a sudden is like life-changing for them? And they say, wow, I love being an entrepreneur. That's what I want to go do. I actually had a couple kids at the business fair that, you know, like they were just lit up. I mean, I actually knew these kids. They live in my neighborhood. And it was just amazing to see them sort of take ownership and be like, I'm super into this thing. And, you know, it's like, wow, like maybe that's going to be your job in the future. I don't know. But like, it's cool that you're super excited about it.
Nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with that. How, as you're going to start with renting a building,
yeah,
or renting a space, or
yep,
stuff like that. I mean, how now, you know, physical education. I mean, it seems very much academic that we've been discussing, yep, stuff like that. Physical education and movement and stuff like that is also part of the thing. And I mean, I've probably got some arts and,
right,
you know, which obviously,
yes,
you can handle inside of a building. But how do you plan to handle physical education?
That's a great question. And actually, probably, you know, I sort of mentioned early on that each Acton sort of has a different focus, and some of them focus on religious, some of them whatever. My focus is actually going to be outdoors, because I might even go so far as saying like one day a week's going to be outside, because I actually think outdoor education is can be really transformative for kids, particularly like, you know, I have two sons, and so I see their struggle of taking a young boy and trying to get them to sit still for as long as they have to sit still in class, you know, and you get them outside and it's a different ball game. For one, they can then come back and do stuff academically and do much better, but there's just a lot of benefits for being outdoors. And so actually John Fishback and I are talking about how can we like build a program where we'd have a big outdoor component. So that won't be necessarily sports. I mean, some of it might be sports.
Right.
Some of it might be like, hey, we're gonna go hop in the van and we're gonna go hiking or we're gonna do whatever type of thing. But yeah, I think we'll be outdoors a lot more than a traditional school will be.
You ought to be like the sleeper lacrosse school.
Yeah.
Nobody ever heard of Acton Academy. Next thing you know, they're coming in and taking the taking the thing. It'd be kind of funny. But, you know, and again, that's, you know, your physical education is not necessarily sports, not organized sports,
right,
either. And I mean, you know, we live in an area where we're so rich with the environment, with the Chesapeake Bay, with the Severn River, all the tributaries. We've got,
right,
you know, the parks we have in the county are great to be able to do it. And I love the idea of, okay, it's we're getting out for a day.
Yeah, and you know, one of the beauties of starting small too is that literally I'm going to buy a big van, like one of those big passenger vans. I can take the kids anywhere, like in that thing. It doesn't have to be like a big plan. So they're like, hey, we want to go paddleboarding one day.
Let's go.
Like, let's go paddleboarding, right? Like, let's go kayaking, like whatever, right? Like, it's not that the overhead of doing an outdoor adventure is not very high.
My high school had a tradition of, it was called the school walk.
Yeah.
And it was a 12 or 13 mile walk through the woods, and it was a boarding school, and they had the cafeteria staff prepare a cookout lunch down by the creek and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But we knew it happened in the fall, but we never knew what it was. And it was just whenever the head of the school woke up and either did or didn't have a bug up his butt.
Really?
Would say, yeah, it's today. And
that's great.
And then be like, hey guys, let's go. No books, no school.
Yeah.
It's a school walk.
Yeah.
And you know, we get in our groups and we would just, you know, walk with our friends, and it was just a great,
yeah,
respite from, you know, the 9 to 5, if you will, of,
yeah,
of just, you know, reading, writing, and arithmetic. I mean, I learned on rote as opposed to,
yeah,
you know, student led learning, but
yeah,
it was wonderful to get out and reconnect with nature. And I mean, my girlfriend and I love to get out and hike. We did the first hike on January,
yeah,
1st up in Gunpowder, I guess it was.
Oh, nice.
So very neat. MarylandCuriosityLab.org is where you want to go, and that's all spelled out.
Roman Hardgrave has a great concept coming up. I think I'm excited to see what happens, where you end up opening up that first location. And I imagine there will be a second location at some point as you grow, and then maybe a third, and then we'll see some gold shovels going into the ground someplace at some point as you move on. Is there anything else that we need to know about?
No, I don't think so. I really appreciate you taking the time to chat with me, John. You've been super supportive right from the beginning.
Well, it sounds like it's growing. I mean, I don't want to say it doesn't sound like you don't have an idea. You certainly do.
Yeah.
But the final formation and the gel of it is really going to be not determined by you in a business plan hand written down. It's going to be determined by the families that come in here.
That's right.
And the children, the students that come in here.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, I mean, you're getting the buy-in from the families immediately. You're getting buy-in from the kids pretty close to immediately. I mean, there might be a little bit of a
transition.
And I imagine certainly the younger, it's easier for the younger ones to start.
That's actually very true. Yeah.
Then to go through, and it'd be kind of exciting to step back here in probably another 12 and a half years and find that first kid that's done the whole.
Yeah, you know, it's actually funny you say that, because like there's this moment when the first kids graduate from the Acton schools, and some of the other Actons have now been around long enough that they're having those moments.
Right.
And it's really amazing to see what happens to a kid if they go through this sort of environment their whole school life, and, you know, and what kind of kids do you get out of there? And reading the stories is really, it's one of those things that inspires and keeps you going when you're dealing with a lot of the, you know, the difficulties.
One thing I wish the public schools would do, and I challenge you to do it as you move forward with the Acton Academy, is to keep track of your students and your alumni.
Yeah.
Not like they're roaming out around on Ritchie Highway or anything like that.
Right.
That too. That's important. But what have they done? I have asked the public schools. They tout their STEM programs.
Yeah.
They say it's a great STEM program and everything else. They've got some testing and stuff like that they can do. But what I want to know as a parent is how many of their STEM graduates went into STEM majors in college, graduated in STEM majors in college, and are working in STEM careers.
Yeah.
And what types of careers are? Private schools are a little bit better on what, you know, what our alumni do, because they're shaking them down for money every time you turn around.
Yeah.
But, you know, to be able to turn around and say, and it doesn't necessarily need to be say, okay, well, they went through this program or that program, but to sit there and say, hey, look, this is our alumni. They're working on Wall Street today. They joined the Peace Corps and they're doing wonderful things all across the world. You know, whatever it may be, I think it's so important to parents and students as they come in, as they get a little bit older, to sit there and see what the possibilities are as you move forward. Because really, their possibilities are truly endless.
Yeah.
When you think about what you can and can't do. I mean, you know, I grew up in a thing where like, you can or you shouldn't do that.
Yeah.
And, you know, asking why is a great answer for that. But definitely keep track of and where the successes are. And I mean, because you're going to find the people that come out of this, the ones that are thinking, that are creating their own path and everything else, are going to continue to do that as they go through college, beyond.
Yeah.
And, you know, they're going to be the, you know, the Zuckerbergs and the, I would say Musk, but he's like, he's on the outs right now, but, you know, of the world.
Yeah.
And it'd be just a great way to look back on this. This is going to be a great legacy for you. I think it's, you know, is your wife involved in it too?
She is. Yeah, she is.
Is she a teacher?
No, she's a full-time accountant actually for a firm in Annapolis. And so she's going to be handling all the finances for us. And so I've swept her into that.
Oh, you got to have finances. That's right. I'm sure at this point, since you're not there, tuition hasn't been set, but I mean, I'm sure it's obviously tuition-based.
It is tuition-based. I mean, and the goal is to be, you know, accessible to middle-class families, right? And so I'm trying to make it as cheap as I possibly can. to where your common middle class family, two parents working, it's not that they don't have an opportunity to do it. Because I think some of the private schools are just like, you know, like even for me, Montessori, I remember when my kids were little, it was just like, I had three kids. I was like, I don't know how you could afford to send three kids to Montessori school based on the tuitions I was seeing. It was just like, this is crazy. The hope is not to be a thing where only people who are really wealthy can access this. I'm also hoping to have some scholarships set up. So
you look for people and money and stuff like that to be able to supplement that as well. Yeah. Which is wonderful that you're looking to make it as accessible to everybody and not crazy, crazy expensive. Right. I know, you know, I'm divorced. I know I had three kids all in private school at one point.
Yeah.
And got divorced and all of a sudden my wallet was screaming like, no, 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 make a change. And we slid over to the public school. But it's this is exciting. Do you have any idea where you're looking as far as to locate this?
I'm very close. So hopefully I'll be able to announce a location here in this month. It's my goal. It's in January. I'm looking mostly Savannah Park and Arnold. It's going to be in that area. There's a few other ones that might be outside of that, but my final real targets are Savannah Park and Arnold.
It's going to be that peninsula coming down from down on this side of the Severn.
That's right. Yeah.
Fantastic. MarylandCuriosityLab.org. Roman Hardgrave, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, John. I really appreciate the time.
Thanks for listening to this week's Local Business Spotlight. Please make sure to visit ionanapolis.net for all your local news, events, and opinion. And in case you haven't already, please subscribe to the Ion Annapolis Daily News Brief, where we bring you all the day's local news direct to your phone, tablet, or computer in about 10 minutes. It comes to you at 6 a.m. every Monday through Friday, and you can subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, or wherever you get your podcasts.